The very few examples of electron microscope pictures of HIV were actually examples of culturing. They were created in the laboratory. There's no published picture of HIV from a blood sample, a tissue sample. You can't find HIV in humans. Even the manufacturer on the front page, the third paragraph of the instructions, say do not use the viral load test to diagnose either AIDS or HIV. The PCR viral load test at best is looking at 3% of the genome of HIV. It's essentially looking at viral debris.
Viral load tests measure what's called HIV RNA. RNA is the part of the HIV virus that knows how to replicate itself. Scientists are able to identify HIV RNA in a person's blood, and by using the PCR method, the HIV RNA can be replicated in a laboratory test tube. The results of these tests are given as number of HIV RNA copies per milliliter of blood, similar to a T4 cell count.
The HIV genomes have been divided in many types. If all these are RNAs of a retrovirus, HIV, and if all the tests, the three tests, were measuring the viral load, then one would have expected all these numbers to be exactly the same. And yet, one can have, from no virus detected, no viral load at all, to up to a million.
The major proponents of the HIV hypothesis, Tom Merrigan at Stanford, Martin Markowitz, who works with David Ho at the Aaron Diamond, John Mellors at Pittsburgh, I've asked them, what does the viral load test have to do with infectious virus? Within a heartbeat, the answer is nothing. And the reason they have to say the viral load test has nothing to do with infectious virus is because that's what their own papers say themselves. The viral load test has nothing to do with infectious virus, and yet infectious virus is the only virus that causes disease.
Sex, blood, death, and numbers. That's an inescapably good combination to sell papers.
If they only have one microbe to warn you about, if there's one virus equals one disease, and there's one thing that you should do to prevent it, and that is to have safe sex or not share needles. That's a very easy message for the press to pick up on.
I certainly do believe that the media has a responsibility also, and that responsibility is to report fairly on all of the latest breakthroughs and whatever it may be it health, via technologies, that the media has that responsibility.
Truth becomes lost in the glitter of one side and the apparent mundaneness of the other side.
As members of the Fifth Estate, the press has been vested with the public trust and has an obligation to report the truth. Has the media been laxed in its responsibility to fairly report all aspects, all views of the HIV/AIDS challenge? As journalists, there is a big responsibility. You need to consider how you cover a story, how you've been gathering information, the reliability of your sources. There is a need to see both sides of an issue impartially. Unfortunately, all too often, journalists are hampered by the thought of losing their jobs or simply not being published because of the controversial nature of their findings.
When I was first reporting on the views of scientists who challenged the HIV story, I really thought that my colleagues would be quick to pick up and look at this themselves too soon. And I was amazed that instead of doing that, they not only ignored the critique, but they actually attacked me and the Sunday Times for having raised these issues, that this whole thing is a kind of house of cards. It's an illusory thing, where our good feelings, allied with greed and ambition and things like that, but primarily often our good feelings, have led us into a huge trap where an unvalidated theory has been marketed to the world and today is causing untold harm.
The Journal of the American Medical Association, the British Medical Journal, The Lancet, Nature, and the New England Journal of Medicine, the five most respected medical journals in the world, will not allow dissonant views on the cause or treatment of AIDS. How then does one encourage the dialogue to challenge the orthodoxy?
The five major medical publications in the world will not allow dissonant views on the cause or treatment of AIDS or any information around it. How then are you going to encourage a dialogue that could challenge the orthodoxy?
The two main aspects of the hypothesis are that AIDS is caused exclusively and finally by HIV, and secondly, that this is universally infectious and will cause a pandemic by heterosexual transmission in the general population. Now, The Lancet has published some stuff, mainly by me, in the form of letters, which cast doubt on those two essential pillars of the hypothesis. They haven't published much else, and the other journals have published nothing at all. They've been asked to do so again and again by myself and others.
Reporters came, asked these questions, and found them, my views or my hypothesis, very logical and convincing. But they never aired them because they were censored at the highest level, presumably when an executive producer would have called the National Institute of Health, is it all right to show this view advanced by Duisberg from Berkeley.
I submitted a manuscript to journal, Nature's and others, to publish my finding and to publish the impact of medication and the corticosteroid on the influence on the AIDS epidemics. And I am a pathologist and toxicologist, but they rejected the articles. The main Journal of Immunology, New England Journals, and Nature's and Science, they are publishing only one side of you.
There must be someone who has the authority, who has the ear of the media, who will sit down with a group of the leading scientists, including a number of Nobel Prize winners, who have this different perspective of HIV/AIDS, who know of the problems of the HIV paradigm. There is a need to sit down with these people and to hear what they have to say.
We have had great difficulty with a fairly short paper based entirely on data in the UK and USA, all verifiable, all factual, and coming from an immense and well-validated database in both countries. We cannot get that published. It's only 4,000 words. We cannot get it published. We sent it to the BMJ, the Lancet, the New England Journal of Medicine, the Journal of the Royal Society of Medicine, and we've discussed it in other quarters, and they will not only not publish it, they will not give reasons for not publishing it, and they did not subject it to peer review. Now, I think, Gary, you should get those editors and ask them all individually to give you the reasons.
In fact, the World Health Organization accused me personally, when I was writing on these articles, of being responsible for millions more projected deaths. Millions more projected deaths in the UK, definitely, and, you know, worldwide. They were saying by raising these issues in an important paper like the Sunday Times, you will be doing so much damage to our efforts to tell people about this peril that is awaiting. And they would believe this when they were saying it. I can't think of another national newspaper, any other national newspaper, that came to the support of the Sunday Times when it was doing this. All the medical and science correspondents were united in either being silent on the issue, or else they would be ready to join in with others in attacking the Sunday Times and accusing it of irresponsibility.
Censorship in the gay press is a tragedy, a disgrace. It's been almost complete. There are people in this city who work quite hard to try and create the space in which a proper discussion can be had.
AIDS was subsequently cooked up in 1981-82 to explain why certain groups of people were ill. But nobody seemed to ask the one simple question. Are we absolutely sure that all these so-called high-risk groups of people would have been perfectly well without HIV? And the answer to that has to be no.
As I continued to work the issue as a journalist, I gradually became more and more skeptical. At the same time, I was also involved in AIDS activism and could see how the organizations changed over the years. activists who are concerned about finding a solution to AIDS would grab onto. They would be interested as I attempted to share my growing doubts about the HIV-AIDS model. And instead, I saw people clinging to HIV with an almost religious fervor.
It's become very difficult for gay media to promote a perspective which is not dependent on the HIV causes AIDS hypothesis, because if they did, they'd risk losing all their funding and going out of business. You know, it's a kind of commercial reality, if you like. One of the things I found very surprising is the degree to which journalists, science journalists, have just followed the medical industry line and not seriously challenged it to a large extent. For example, I had an African journalist staying with me, and he turned around and said to me, if what you're saying is true, then surely other well-known journalists would have been talking about it by now. Well, it just so happened that I had within arm's reach Neville Hodgkinson's AIDS, The Failure of Contemporary Science. Neville Hodgkinson, of course, being a former Sunday Times science writer. So I reached out and showed it to him, and he just didn't want to know. And that seems to be a widespread phenomenon in the media. They just don't want to know. And I find that astonishing from a profession which is supposed to be truth-seeking.
It's anathema, it shouldn't ever be mentioned. If the great and the good say this is so, it must be so because everybody says so. But so therefore there's bound to be some form of censorship.
And whenever I or anyone else raises the argument that we should start looking at the alternative views, we're immediately told that we're being highly irresponsible, that we're encouraging the gay community into things like unsafe sex, and we're being completely and utterly disregarding the anxieties of people who have HIV and AIDS, because we're creating doubts and anxieties that they don't need. And this is quite wrong, because as a journalist, I believe in totally open debate in whatever the area should be.
Truth is simple. Truth is ordinary. Thomas Jefferson said he could not believe any matter of the conduct of our life could be a matter of science, because he says for every man of science there are thousands who are not. What would become of them? Here are the thousands who are not. And I agree with Thomas Jefferson. The truth about the conduct of life is simple, is ordinary. It is about you and I, ordinary people, living our lives in good and helpful ways. But that lacks glamour, it lacks newsworthiness.
And the truth is that if you're a journalist who says, I'm going to report the truth in today's market where a few very powerful people control the media outlets in most countries, you'll lose your job.
Anyone who tries to venture into this field of trying to report fairly and accurately all sides of the story will immediately be pushed out onto the margins and told that they're being irresponsible and that they are trying to support people whose views are just not credible and they're nutters. And so the journalists themselves will be then become treated as nutters and as rogues. And so they begin to lose their credibility. And so it's a very brave journalist who puts forward any of these views, because immediately he's in danger of having his whole journalistic career discredited.
One of the best defenses of the AIDS establishment is telling you that it's far too complex for you to understand. You can't possibly understand it. Don't try, just trust us. And that has been very successful so far. At some point in time, and I hope it's not in the too distant future, we will be looking back on AIDS and saying, how could we have been bamboozled for so long? How come nobody spoke up?
The current generation have too much to lose of orthodoxy, of journalists. They've invested their lives in trying to be helpful to the AIDS debate. They think that their journalism is helping. In actual fact, it's based on a false premise. Now, they're not going to backtrack, neither the journalists nor the scientists. Nobody's going to backtrack. There's too much to lose.
Either they cover it with ridicule, or they don't even mention it at all, because they seem to think that would mislead the public, give them a false impression, might make them more relaxed about having safe sex, etc.
And so there's a kind of absence of skepticism, an absence of critical thinking, which in part has explained how AIDS has been able to be interpreted only one single way, which is it's caused by a virus, sexual behavior is at the root of it, changing your sexual behavior is what will make you free of AIDS.
Africa is a country where they say everyone has so much sex all the time that they're spreading this virus terribly and that the lorry drivers are spreading it up and down the big highways.
Malaria, malnutrition, the lack of elementary facilities, the abuse of women, the neglect of children, all of those things conspire towards creating what appears to be registrations of a huge pandemic.
Poverty is the main factor of AIDS in Africa, which is not the case, of course, in the States or in Europe.
Weight loss of greater than 10% of your body weight, chronic diarrhea, a persistent fever and cough.
By that definition, a Western researcher like myself has had AIDS.
The test picked up immune system activation from this great variety of causes. People were testing positive in millions who had nothing to do with any new disease agent.
In Africa, what's called AIDS is simply relabeling other diseases. People are ill from malnutrition, which causes immune deficiency, malaria, which causes immune deficiency, TB, which affects your immune system.
Since you have two things going on with tuberculosis. Number one, it cross-reacts on the HIV antibody tests, and number two, it can cause T-cell depletion all by itself. Then you've got a big problem in Africa. Do these people have AIDS or do they have tuberculosis?
What AIDS has become in Africa is a great distraction. It distracts us from the questions of better foods, clean drinking water, more appropriate ways to dispose of toxic waste, and it puts the burden back on Africans and their alleged promiscuous sexual activity.
Is it because of their sexual behavior? Absolutely not.
A definition was arrived at as a result of a World Health Organization sponsored conference in October of 1985. The Bangui definition of an AIDS case in Africa is based on four clinical symptoms: high fever, a persistent cough, loose stools for 30 days, and a 10% loss of body weight over a two-month period.
Any person with severe starvation has AIDS regardless of HIV positive or HIV negatives, because starvation causes atrophy of the lymphoid system.
But instead of giving these people clean water, nutritious and adequate food, what do they need? Well, they need condoms, and they need expensive and toxic drugs.
It's a tangled web of madness. By calling all those things AIDS, by just making it more and more and more complicated to figure out what causes what. See, it's like, that's not the way science works. It's a real bizarre thing to have 100,000 people being paid to do something that strange, to take a whole bunch of diseases, to lump them all into this one big thing, this great, I mean, pretty soon, there won't be anything that's not AIDS. If they keep going at the rate they're going, you say, well, let's see what'll happen in 100 years. How many diseases will be on that list?
Among people who are well-to-do or middle class, if you have the symptoms that define an AIDS case, you have a wealthy or wealthier middle-class African businessman or professional, or an Indian, an Asian, or a European who has a high fever, or a persistent cough, or diarrhea, or is losing weight, those people by definition are going to go to a doctor. They're going to seek out medical treatment. But in the case of impoverished Africans, it is assumed that these symptoms have come about because of their sexuality, because of their sexual behavior.
Africa is always described as the place where, because 50% of the HIV cases are in women, that heterosexual spread is to blame. It's all wrong. And it is not only wrong, it is a crime to do this to that continent and to those people.
Much of what is claimed about AIDS in Africa is not only based on weak statistics and dubious numbers, it's also based on a kind of racist, arrogant set of assumptions that were popular 100 years ago, but now have been brought back into vogue.
The claims often made by AIDS researchers about African sexuality take us back to the 19th century. They take us back to the Victorians. They take us back to old National Geographics from 70 years ago with the strange sexual customs of the natives kind of thinking.
What is the benefit of all the billions upon billions of dollars that are spent fighting the so-called African AIDS crisis? Many believe that money could have been much better spent elsewhere.
A question comes up about what happens to patients in clinics around Africa. Doctors find themselves short of basic medication. They find them short of staff. They find that their budgets have been savaged over the last 15 or 20 years, but there is plenty of money to distribute AIDS literature, condoms, and most damagingly, in my mind, so-called AIDS medications.
It's very hard for people in Africa to turn down foreign currency, big grants of foreign currency, to reject the paradigm that that money is coming for, of promoting the HIV-AIDS theory. Even if their heart tells them that it's wrong, very hard for them to speak out against it when they can earn more from attending some conference on AIDS than they get paid by their government in a year, which is the case in a number of African countries.
The money in Africa is riding on a large number of people being diagnosed with HIV and AIDS. All of the organizations in Africa that have money are associated with AIDS.
If someone came along and told them there is no AIDS, all there is the same diseases that Africans have been dying of all along, then all of a sudden millions of dollars of funding would dry up.
In 1988, Dr. Philip Crinan and his wife trained in tropical medicines before moving to Africa to help AIDS orphans. They were told that this was an epicenter of AIDS in Africa, where more than 50% of people had HIV and AIDS. But upon arrival, they did preliminary testing and found that only 13% of the population tested positive, not 50%. Shortly thereafter, they did more definitive testing and found that the number fell below 5%.
It is the first time in Africa that a village has volunteered as a whole to be tested for a dreadful disease, that everybody has got his results, and that the truth has been 5 times lower than the figures given by the World Health Organization or the AIDS Control Program.
When a person had tested HIV positive, he would give them support, nutritional support, help with housing, help with drugs for the illnesses that they actually suffered, like it might be TB or intestinal infections. He would give them direct help for what might otherwise have been called AIDS. But he would give them the medicines appropriate to their actual diseases, and he would give them nutritional support. And he found that these people, after a period of support like this, had lower death rates. This is the people who've tested positive and who his charity was set up to help.
Because of AIDS, with the diseases which are called AIDS here, which are similar to the symptoms of AIDS, they are less and less since now 2 years.
He ended up by saying, you know, Neville, after 5 years, we've concluded that there's no AIDS and no AIDS orphans. And since that time, he's had a policy that his charity and the regions that it serves have completely renounced the HIV-AIDS story altogether. They just have nothing more to do with it because they think it does such harm.
How can you ask people who believe they're going to die tomorrow, how can you ask them to look into the future, which are the children? They give up. They don't invest. They don't want to come to work in Northern Kagera because they think they're going to die of AIDS or to contract it.
The World Health Organization claims that 10 million HIV-positive Africans are responsible for 300,000 cases of AIDS reported since 1981. Unlike in developed countries, where over 90% of the AIDS cases are promiscuous homosexual males, intravenous drug users, and blood transfusion recipients, African AIDS is supposedly suffered by men and women in equal numbers, who contract it presumably through heterosexual intercourse. The African figures are often cited by the AIDS establishment and safe sex activists in Europe and the United States to prove that everybody is at equal risk.
this has become a calling. This has become a kind of endeavor fighting AIDS, in which people who believe in what they're doing cannot, in good conscience, hold a contrary thought. It's what psychologists call the mentality of taboo. Holding a critical thought, if you are in the AIDS orthodoxy, is against the rules. It's a taboo because it means, or it suggests to mean, that you are turning your back on the people that you are supposed to be helping. The cure for AIDS in Africa is as near at hand as an alternative hypothesis as to what is making Africans sick in the first place. And that is what I strongly recommend people do before giving any more money to these AIDS organizations.
If you ask me, are people sicker today than they were 30 years ago? I would answer you based upon my knowledge of what is taking place in Somalia, Ethiopia, Kenya, Senegal,